Hey there, welcome to Life Noggin. Sound is a beautiful thing. It's what allows us to listen to music, communicate verbal language, and hear birds chirping on a summer morning. I love all of those things, except the birds because they wake me up. But how are we able to hear all that? What is it about our ears that allows us to hear? To answer that, first we need to discuss the physics of a sound wave. These are longitudinal waves that travel through a medium, and therefore there is no sound in a vacuum like space. Sorry, Star Wars. But simply put, sound waves are variations of pressure caused by some type of vibration, like an oscillating violin string, or the vocal folds that vibrate as you speak. These pressure variations can be modeled by a sine wave, where the peaks represent increased pressure and the troughs represent decreased pressure. To visualize that, let's think of a slinky. If you and your friend hold the ends and you move your hand back and forth, the areas where the slinky is compressed represent areas of increased pressure, called compressions, and the areas where the slinky is stretched represents areas of decreased pressure, called rarefactions. A few important aspects of this wave include the frequency and the amplitude. Looking at this sine wave, the frequency is defined as how many wavelengths or complete cycles pass a specific point in 1 second. And this value is eventually perceived as pitch, with 20 Hz as the lowest humans can hear and 20 kHz as the highest. The amplitude of the wave, measured as how the air pressure deviates from the equilibrium, determines the sound wave's intensity, which is eventually perceived as the sound's loudness. And this is usually represented by the nonlinear decibel scale, where a normal conversation is around 60 decibels and a rock concert is around 120 decibels. But for all you rock fans, keep in mind that the threshold of pain occurs around 130 decibels. You definitely don't want to get too much higher than that. But anyway, now that we know all of this, we can finally move on to what happens in the ear. Let's begin with the part we see, called the pinna. It collects the sound waves and sends it into the ear canal where the sound is amplified. And fun fact, this is where earwax forms, coating the ear canal to moisturize it, fight off infection, and help keep debris from getting into your inner ear. And if you're Shrek, it also allows you to make candles. Gross. But once the sound wave passes through the ear canal, it reaches your eardrum, or tympanic membrane. This transfers the wave's vibrations through the tiny bones called the ossicles, eventually reaching the inner ear. From here, we have two main structures. The semicircular canals, which are in charge of balance, and the cochlea, which is what we really care about. See, this is essentially your body's microphone, converting sound pressure waves into electrical impulses that are eventually sent to the auditory nerve and then to the brain. And this transition occurs in the organ of Corti, which sounds way too royal to be a body part. Anyway, this sits on top of the basilar membrane and contains up to 20,000 tiny hair cells. And the place among this membrane where the most hair cells are excited determines the pitch of the sound. Lastly, as the signals pass through the auditory nerve, they reach various areas of the brain like the auditory cortex, and voila, you can hear. Don't forget to come back every Monday for a brand new video. As always, I'm Blocko, this has been Life Noggin. Don't forget to keep on thinking.